We get started. Good evening, everyone. Before we begin, I'd like to note that this meeting is being recorded by audio and visual devices and is not being televised. I'd like to call to order a roundtable between the City Council and the School Committee Tuesday, February 14th, 2017, to have a preliminary discussion on the fiscal year 18 school department budget. Thank you all for being here. I can't think of any other people I'd rather spend Valentine's Day with than all of you.
Well, that goes for us, too.
Happy
Valentine's Day. Also, good wishes are to, I understand that Dr. Turk took a little bit of a fall today, so she is not going to be with us, so hopefully she is recovering and doing well. So this meeting really came out of, after a number of years of the school committee and city council having their budget conversations typically in April or May when the budget is really already completed. Every year there's this discussion about, gee, we wish we got together sooner so that we had a better understanding of what were some of the challenges being faced by the school committee and the school department. What are some of the things that they're thinking about? What are some of the reasons why, given that, you know, a pretty healthy budget, there are often financial sort of constraints. And a lot of those conversations come up at the end of the process rather than earlier on. We talked about, the city manager and I had talked about doing this even earlier than now, going back to the fall. But obviously we weren't quite sure when we were talking about this as to who the manager was going to be. Then we had the fire, then we had the holidays, and we had, you know, and all of a sudden it can quickly get away from you if you're not careful. So although this is certainly earlier than at any other time that we've sat down and had this conversation, you know, there's still opportunity to, in coming years, to maybe do it even sooner than this. Just to, you know, to be clear, you know, this is an opportunity, and the reasoning behind this was really just an opportunity for us to have a conversation and try to just be a little bit more on the same page earlier on in the process. I think it goes without saying, having been on the school committee for 8 years and budget co-chair, I think, 4 of those years, you know, I totally understand the relationship between the school committee and the city council and what the different roles are, and I am very respectful of that. So I don't view this, and I hope folks don't view this as the council trying to micromanage the school committee. That's not what our role is. But it is an opportunity just to have a conversation because we get, we get questions too, you know, from folks in the community about the school budget, and it helps us if we're better informed. It's going to help us to better support the work that you guys are doing on the school committee. So. That's sort of the way I do this. And I guess that's kind of all I have for opening comments. The agenda for tonight, we're going to go to Kathleen and Richard, Kathleen Kelly, Richard Harding, who are the budget co-chairs for the school committee, who are going to walk us through some of the process thus far, I guess, and what lies ahead. We will then go to City Manager Louis DePasquale, who will talk about what's been done between the school department and the city thus far. Superintendent Dr. Kenneth Saleem will talk about the school department and what they're thinking about, and then we'll open it up for general questions and discussion. So without further ado, I don't know, Kathleen, are you starting? Or?
I think I'll start off. What I wanted to say was with my co-chair, Richard Harding, we developed actually a very comprehensive process this time around. So we have had multiple roundtables on different parts of the budget where we knew we wanted to have the committee get together with the district. We had it on educational technology, on world language, on the staffing at the high school, on the Office of Student Services, and also on English language learners, which actually was a very critical one because the state law has changed on what's considered proficiency. And all of these had budget implications. We've also had presentations about the leveling up on the ninth grade. We had one in January through the Curriculum and Achievement Subcommittee, which included the curriculum coordinators, Principal Smith and Carolyn Turk. And then a month later, on February 7th, they came back with a more fleshed out model. We've also had a presentation regarding the kindergarten lottery and also the presentation on how we're going to move forward with world language. In addition, we've had four public hearings so far. We had a community hearing, actually, starting off in November. And we also had an educator public hearing in January, and we had two other public hearings. We had a meeting regarding the committee's priorities about the budget on February 2nd, and multiple budget reports and retreats. And as part of that, also went through the projections and enrollment and our five-year forecast that we always have. But what I really appreciated, and I hope that the committee appreciated this as well, is we really dove into a number of topics deeply that had budget implications in a way that we haven't done in the past. We had first thought about it at a department level, but really what we took on was what we had identified as critical issues. I would say that the two areas where we have had challenges has been around the special ed, particularly the out-of-district placements and transportation. And we've had some discussions about that and what we might do, but that's still under discussion and really hasn't been decided by the committee. So it sort of introduces you to the process. We're about halfway through when I look at the calendar. We started on November 1st. It's in February now. And then the superintendent will be making his presentation in March on the first round of the projected budget for the next fiscal year. And I'm sure that Mr. Harding will have, my co-chair will have things to add as well.
Thank you, Mr. Harding.
Thank you. So thank you, co-chair Kelly, Vice Mayor and Governor. So I think for me, I think the co-chair spoke too much of the process. I think for us in this space, I think the best utilization of our time is to really think about what it is globally from a big picture, broad view that counselors have as not only ideas but thoughts about what it is that can help us move the system forward. I'm very clear on the responsibility of who makes the decisions, but I do think to move the decisions in a way that's harmonious, I think it's good to hear early what some of the thoughts or concerns are so that we can go deliberate with our membership that's charged with running schools. I think from what I've gathered over the last couple of budget periods, I think that what I would want the counselors to know is that we're not necessarily eviscerating any of the progress that we've made over the last couple of years and what you've walked with us in that journey, and I thank you for your support. But we are really looking at what, from a more critical lens, is working, what's not working, and how we could effectively hand the school budget and the stewardship of the school off to our new superintendent. So it's been somewhat different a process, I think, for us because, you know, our superintendent is very, very new. He's been here only months. But I think what we've learned quickly is that some of the things that we collectively, both on the city council side and the school committee side, that we've talked about over time. Some of those things still persist, quite frankly. There's, you know, things, some things have gotten better, but some things still persist. And so we hope that our budget will reflect the persistent negative things. We hope that the budget will hopefully address some of that. And some of that's continuous progress on things that we've talked about in the past. I think as we talk through this, I think there are some issues that have come up on our side of the aisle that, quite frankly, it would have been helpful to kind of have this meeting to talk through. We talked last week about some issues around the space in schools and how that's going to work in terms of the capacity that we're going to need, seeing a spike of enrollment, the spike in enrollment that we've seen. And I think that's something that we all think is positive, but also causes its own conflict within the school buildings. We talked about the new King School building where, you know, 3 days after the building opened, you know, there was some conflict already, and that's partially, in a strange way, a good thing because we're utilizing the building and we're doing all the things that we dream of, but at the same time, it does cause some conflict as you're thinking about program moving forward, as you all will walk with us as we build two new schools, for instance. We've also been taking a critical look at just the data that shows student success and student achievement in a way that we think you'd be proud of, but also looking at our shortcomings to that end. And then lastly, I would just say we've seen and we are trying to address some of the irregularities, I'd say, around some of the funding mechanisms that you usually would see around special ed and other things, where we're seeing an exorbitant amount of transportation costs and different things that we're dealing with and that we're challenged with. And the last thing I would say is I think that we're also trying to make sure that the superintendent and your side, Mr. DePasquale, and the finance people begin to build that relationship that is going to be necessary to run a successful school system in a harmonious way. We're all working collaboratively together. So I look forward to the conversation. I think it may be a little bit overdue, but I'm glad we're here now. And I do think that each of us will learn a little bit more about what each other's thinking so that we can hopefully meet at a bridge called collaboration and move this budget forward. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. And just real quickly on, you know, what Mr. Hardy talked about, you know, the collaboration piece. I think it's also important for, I don't want this to be a one-way conversation. I've been on that side of the table too, because there are decisions that we're making at City Council that impact the schools. So, as you said about Mr. Harding, as you talked about, the buildings are, you know, obviously an obvious one, but as we're increasing housing production in the city, you know, that is bringing, you know, not as many families because of the type of housing that it is, but it is certainly bringing some. And given that we have and believe in small schools, you know, if we're building thousands of units, if that only translates to 300 more kids, that's a huge impact on you guys. So, you know, being able to hear from you also about decisions and conversations that we're having in City Council that are going to impact you. I certainly hope that the school administration and the school committee feel as comfortable pressing us and asking us about things that we're doing as we do about asking you what you're doing.
Vice Mayor McGovern, I'd actually like to follow up on that point because, in fact, the way housing being built at North Point and housing being built in the Aylwave area has significantly impacted our costs in transportation. Because of the controlled choice, so you're not having all the kids in that neighborhood go to the same neighborhood school. So we've had to take on additional contracts for smaller buses to take smaller groups of students. Say, this set of students is going to Graham and Parks, this set of students is going Kennedy Longfellow, this is, and so that is, you know, how we develop our housing and housing patterns in the city does have a significant impact on our transportation costs.
Thank you. Mr. Snowden.
When would you like those kind of comments? I'm happy to wait until the end.
Yeah, so what we're going to do, so, for, you know, just again, to go over the agenda again, so we've heard from the budget co-chairs of the school committee. I'd like to go to the city manager, then we'll go to the superintendent, and then we're going to open it up to more general comments and conversation. So, Louie, you want to take over?
Sure. See if this is on.
Great.
broken already?
What would be the budget for that?
I think this is on purpose.
Just switch chairs.
Thank you. I'm glad to see it's not only our chamber that has problems, audio problems.
Is that on the priority list?
It is now. Okay, so I just want to start off by saying, for me, this is my 35th year as either budget director, finance director, or this year for the first time city manager dealing with the school. And I have to say that in those whole 35 years, I've been very fortunate to have a city manager who understands the priority of education and has worked incredibly well with every superintendent. It's translated into every finance team on both sides and both the school committee and the city council that we have been able to come up with a balanced budget that makes education a top priority and also recognizes the fact that the school is our largest tax-supported budget because it's our largest budget. And I think this year truly was no exception. I think even though it was the first budget for me as city manager and the first budget for the new superintendent, we hit it off pretty quickly and understood both concerns and came up with a budget that I think is incredibly supportive, but is the appropriate number for the school system. And I'm very happy that we were able to do this, but I think the reason we can do it is because we work on the budget all year round. The school team and the city team is one team when it comes to the numbers. There's no surprises. We're in this together. School is another department that we work with, and we understand the importance of it. And, you know, in FY16, there was a shortfall, and we knew about it early and worked with it and went in for a supplemental appropriation. We built that into 17. As we managed 17, and Gina's had a lot of meetings with the school fiscal staff, we say, how's that going to affect 18? So we go in this, even though the city manager only has bottom-line authority, really with a good working relationship, and I feel an incredibly strong understanding of what the school needs to really keep things going. So I really think that that was important. And I think this year here, when we started off, we recognized that there were some changes that we had to address. Enrollment was growing quickly. Special ed tuition was growing. Transportation costs were going. And we had a new superintendent who had emerging priorities and with the school committee as well. And we wanted to address that. But we also have to address the fact that as much as we want to address all the needs we possibly can, there is tax implications. So we don't have a gold card, but we have a pretty good card as far as I'm concerned, and I think it's a working relationship. So, I mean, in December, the finance teams met to really get an understanding of always where we were this year and where we're going. And that helped us get into two meetings in January of some of the concerns, some of the issues that I talked about, and really get to start off with a number that was already increased because we knew of some of these issues, but wanted to understand further some of the other issues. And I think after two or three meetings, we really came up with a number that we felt worked for both. And I want to just talk about the number, and not because it's so high, but it's because I think it addresses the importance of both the priority we have in it, understanding education, but I think it works for everybody. So this year's tax increase for the school budget was $10.2 million. It's a 6.93% or 7% net tax increase. The reason that's important is because if you take the five-year average, and I know I like to give a lot of averages, but I think it shows a point that the five-year average tax support increase was 5.6, and the 10-year average was 4.7. So we recognized right away that there needed to be more tax dollars to support this budget, and we were going to make it happen. I'd also say tax dollars are obviously driven by the increase in the budget because there's not a lot of non-tax revenue in this budget. So this budget, I'm happy to say, is increased by 6%, but there's a lot of reasons, and I think they're good reasons, and that's why we support it. But the five-year average is about 4.8, and the 10-year average is about 3.4. So again, I think working together, getting an understanding of where we all are, we looked at some of the issues, but we were able to come up with numbers that work for both the city in terms of where we feel the tax rate's going to go,
We went to the rating agencies last week. We built in these numbers. We think they're numbers that keep the tax bills where we feel it's an appropriate number. But again, make school priority a key priority. It will always be a key priority. It's always been a key priority for the 35 years I've been involved in this. And I think I would just say we will continue to have a very strong working relationship. And, you know, I think we work well together. And I think I know we will continue to do that. So I think from my point of view, this has been a very good process. It's been an open process. And I feel the tax number we came up with is something that is fair. It's the right number. And I think it works for everybody. So I just want to say thank you.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Manager, a couple just quick things if you could touch on. So just in terms of what's the number we're looking at, what is, you said a 6% increase, what is that translating to?
So for tax dollars, it's $10.2 million. For the last 3 years, we've recognized that there's been some increased costs. So I think, like I said, we're open to understanding the importance of this budget. So it's gone from 4.5 to 5.7 to 6.1 to roughly 7 because of costs and because there is enrollment going increasing. And I think that you also have to be able to grow with different priorities like the city does. And, you know, so I think the $10.2 million is the highest it's ever been. But I think there's reasons for that. I'm very comfortable supporting that. And I think it's also a number that we've worked into when we take a look at our budgets, because the one thing, it's one budget. School is part of the entire budget. So if the school gets more, then we have to look at our side. And if we give it more, it's going to have more impact on taxes. But we try to balance it out. And based on where I am with the city budgets and based on where the school budget is right now, and it is as part of the city budget, I'm very confident that we will come in with a tax number that the residents will be pleased with, but also, more importantly, that the students of the Cambridge school system will get the best education as possible based on the dollars we're given.
So, and I don't know, Dr. Steen's going to touch on this, but every year we talk about there's sort of this maintenance budget, right, which is to kind of carry the school department over to basically do what they've been doing, but there are increases because of personnel costs or, you know, what have you. Where does this budget, is this beyond that?
I will let the superintendent get into the details, but I think it gives them an opportunity to grow. That was one of the things we talked about when we talked about what some of the priorities for the new superintendent were and what the school committee were. So that's why we increased the number to a higher number. But I know that's in the presentation, so I think I would let him go into the... But that was part of the discussion. What's in it that we know we have to do to keep everything the same, and what's the number we feel is a priority to expand and look at new ideas? And I think, like we do with all our budgets, it's important to be able to grow and address new concerns and new issues, and I think we've done that with the numbers we've provided the superintendent in terms of his property tax number.
Okay. And I know that, I think in the email I was supposed to send you with some questions ahead of time that I never sent you, I was going to ask you this. But in terms of, there are obviously, I mean, there are other departments, in terms of thinking about the money that the city spends on schools, so Human Services has money out of their budget that goes to fund some programs or some things in the schools. The health department covers the nurses. So, I mean, there's at some point, I think, in terms of giving the public a full picture of the money we actually, that the city designates to the school, it's more than just the money that goes to fund the school committee budget, right? There's money that comes from other departments. Sure. That also goes to our schools, and that tells part of the story as well.
Well, clearly we work together, but I think the biggest thing is the debt service budget. With the new schools, which we've all agreed upon, and the city manager, Mr. Haley, started the process, is something that obviously falls on our side. And if you go out based on the next bond sale that we have, and that only does not include anything to do with the Tobin, by the time that sale's over, there'll be about $430 million worth of tax-supported debt related to education. And I think that says the city's commitment towards education, because the buildings will be there. So that runs as true FY41 because 2021. So I think it kind of shows, if you take a look at our five-year plan, I think that in that plan there's $20 million of the probably $160 million that we're estimating for the Tobin. If you phase that out to the length of the sale, it's about $430 million in tax-supported debt. Now, that's also in our plan. It's a factor, and we've still been able to address city needs. But I think the commitments to the school have been real important, but I will state that I was at the first meeting when Mr. Healy, who was one of the top number men I know, said, and whether it's three or four schools is still debatable, but I'll say it. At the original meeting, we thought on the high side, if we did three schools, we might spend $350, and everyone said that seems awfully high, and obviously we're going to spend that and a whole lot more. So we've still been able to do it. Like I said, we went to the rating agencies last week. The Tobin's in our plan. So we feel we can continue it and continue to address the city needs. But I think we have to recognize the fact that there's an incredible amount of debt that's paid on the tax-supported side on the city, and that's the right thing. That's where it belongs, but it is a fact that it has to wear into our whole capital plan.
Thank you. Dr. Sleep, do you want to? Are Mayan going to be in the way here?
No. I think it's okay. So I just thank you, Vice Chair McGovern. What I wanted to do was just to share a handful of slides just to provide some background and context around the process that we've been engaged in.
Can you do that at City Hall?
Sure.
Yeah. So this again, is just a handful of slides, but just to take you through a little bit about how we've been starting to engage in the development of a proposal for FY 18 school department budget. In the context of my first year in Cambridge and a larger entry process that we've been engaged in as a school community. So I'll talk briefly about sort of an overview of the entry process, just some of the stages to situate you and where we are in that process. Talk about the process that we've been engaged in as a cabinet, as a leadership team, along with our principals and with our school community, and then share a set of draft strategic objectives. And I do this because they have been a set of objectives that I have been working on development with the community in order to provide a framework for the budget development for FY18. So just in terms of process, where we are, as you know, we're sort of in that February still top red box time frame where we're engaged in an internal review process on March 14th. I'll present my proposed budget proposal to the school committee, and we'll have certainly public hearings and school committee review and feedback before final revisions and a vote for adoption in the beginning of April, as it's scheduled with the school committee, and then subsequent to that, the city council hearing and appropriation, as was alluded to earlier in terms of the overall process. The entry process that I've been engaged in is comprised of a few different stages, and the first 6 months into January was focused on this entry effort of really what is not uncommon in sort of entry efforts around listening and learning, and trying to understand the best as what I could in as short amount of time as possible the Cambridge Public Schools and some of the opportunities as well as challenges and strengths in the school district. And through that process, spent a full day at each of 18 schools, chatted with students, talked with parents and other family members, with teachers, with a whole host of different staff, custodians, clerks, maintenance staff, the security staff, a whole range of folks throughout the district. But it's not, that entry stage wasn't really only for me to learn about the district, but it was really in service of these next two phases of the entry process, and that's the development of a strategy or a district strategic or improvement plan, and engage in a planning process for the district to really look at multi-year improvement process. And so we're in the process of engaging in root cause analysis of some of the symptoms that we see in the district, both successes as well as challenges related to student performance and other measures. And we're engaged in the process of doing vision setting and strategy development with school councils, as well as with principals and central office administrators and teachers. We're then going to be shifting into really creating those action and implementation plans over the course of summer. So all this is on target to develop a district plan that will be presented as a draft to the school committee in June, with the summer as the opportunity to develop annual action plans for us to be able to develop benchmarks and measure our progress towards meeting those district plan goals. So that's the overall sort of big picture where we've been, where we're headed, related to the district planning process. And of course, this overlays with what we've been doing around the budget process. And part of that budget process has been the development of the draft strategic objectives, or a draft sort of big pillars that we're utilizing as an organizing frame for budget proposals that are guiding the decision making for the FY18 budget. We've been looking, of course, at enrollment and budget projections. You heard budget co-chair Ms. Kelly, as well as our city manager DePasquale, made reference to some of those enrollment and areas, as well as looking at the revenue and budget projections. We've had, as also budget co-chair Kelly referenced, had a number of these roundtables over the course of the fall. So we started in November and sequenced them in such a way on off, typically on off school committee Tuesday nights, for us to be able to engage in roundtable discussions with the school committee about areas that we knew would come up in our budget discussions: high school staffing, technology, world language, English language learner program, special education. And then we've also had budget meetings with principals, coordinators, deans, and then we've had cabinet budget retreats where we've been able to look at proposals, talk about prioritization, and of course the ongoing meetings with the city fiscal staff too. And I sort of summarized the five budget drivers that really kind of shapes the FY18 budget as these five. Certainly enrollment, and enrollment not just here at the high school, where we're going to surpass 2,000 students next year, but also even at our youngest ages. The kindergarten registration has been the highest number of applicants into the lottery than ever before. So we're looking at increasing numbers of a couple kindergarten classrooms potentially. But you also heard a little bit about out-of-district tuition and transportation. These are a couple of outliers that we've seen just grow pretty dramatically, not just going into next year, but even over the last couple of years. And so I'm certainly taking steps to better understand them, but those are ones that we want to account for as part of good budget practice, of trying to anticipate what those costs are before needing, rather than needing to come back for additional funds, so really taking that into account. And then the state requirements. Also, budget co-chair Kelly made reference to some of the changes around English language learner services, what the exit requirements are for students to exit out of the English as a second language, or our sheltered English immersion program. And so that results in a different level of staffing that's needed to meet those needs. So those, and then of course at the top, some of the identified priorities, the things that we have been discussing with the school committee and have identified through the many discussions I've had also at the school level through this entry process. So these are the four strategic objectives, and I do emphasize that these are drafts because they are really, and I'm sort of taking these, I've actually been gathering feedback from our administrative team. I met actually with a group of teachers as part of the superintendent advisory committee a couple weeks ago to also get feedback on some of these objectives. But we wanted to put these out at this point in the year to be an organizing frame for thinking about our budget development and thinking about, as we're considering proposals and considering our needs around funding, that we tie them to these to one of these areas. And so some of these I know will reflect issues and areas that you have discussed as a body before. The first around equity and access, the idea that we want to, as a system, provide opportunities that will to engage in rigorous learning and are grounded in culture proficiency principles that are student-centered. So thinking about how our work around culture proficiency, how our work around thinking about student ownership around, and relevance can be a part of how we think about resources. Support for the whole child, and that's certainly a social-emotional behavioral component, but also the academic needs of students, and how we can support our staffs through effective professional learning, as well as the structures and systems to do that work well in supporting the whole child. The third is around innovation and partnership, this notion that having a system that can look at innovation at different levels, whether that's a school level or classroom level or district level, and how we can really vet those and expand successful innovations in the district in collaboration with families and with community partners. And then the fourth around implementation and progress monitoring. If there's one common theme I heard in all my 18 visits to schools, it was this feeling that there wasn't enough time to do things well, that as soon as, you know, kind of one new initiative, as teachers understood it, was sort of being executed, a new one would be right on the heels of that. And so this inability to really focus on doing things well, to really assess and analyze and evaluate things that maybe could potentially come off the plate. So really thinking about implementation and also monitoring our progress. What are the measures and benchmarks that we want to utilize in order to declare something a success or declare something that either needs improvement or something that needs rethinking. So those four collectively are ways in which we've been thinking about organizing the development of the FY18 budget proposal, and also the work that we're doing as a district collectively in developing a district plan and development strategy. So I just wanted to share those with you as some of the background and leading into tonight's discussion. And then just to give you a little bit of a flavor of how we're also asking department heads and others to present proposals related to resources to us, we're asking them too about alignment to the strategic objectives, but also to think about the work that we're doing in a multi-year time frame. So not just about what we're doing just for FY18, but what would that look like in FY19 and FY20, and then similarly to think about what are the outcomes that we would expect to see as a result of some investment through resources. And we attach certain questions to these, and so these are questions that were answered for each budget proposal that we have been evaluating as a cabinet, and we've been using those to really to prioritize and to vet and to create that ultimately to create that proposal for the 14th of March. So with that, I just wanted to share that background with the committee and with the council as a way to set the stage for the subsequent discussion.
Thank you. Where are we in the, just in terms of the, you have the guiding principles, does that come out of the budget guidelines, or is that, are the budget guidelines from the school committee different than those?
The budget guidelines have largely been the same the last couple of years, so actually the guiding principles come much more from the superintendent, so it's a, but yet, when he's talking about the equity access and all those four categories, it's very similar, but he's looking at it from a much more strategic perspective.
Okay.
I'm sure he can speak for himself.
Yeah, so I think, you know, one of the things that we did as part of this process was to actually, the budget guidelines that, or sort of the school committee budget guidelines, we actually, I want to say in December or November, we actually sort of, voted to basically continue the ones that were utilized last year for FY17. So the strategic objectives in some way provide a kind of a broader organizing frame for how we're thinking about it, but in many ways I think complement the guidelines that exist in the budget book.
And do we have, you talked about the transportation costs, out-of-district costs, the ELL. Do we have, you have figures on those yet as to what they're, what the increase is going to be, or?
We do. We have shared some of that information with the committee. I know that our chief financial officer, Claire Spinner, may have those specific numbers more handy. We can certainly get those to folks as we sort of continue the conversation.
Yeah, and the only reason I think it's important of, you know, when thinking of, it's important for us because on the council, because we get, you know, folks saying, give the school committee money for this, that, or, you know, or what have you. And but I'm not sure if people don't have the figures to show, really, I mean, there's a lot of costs that a lot of these increases are beyond the control of the district, right? And those have to be met. And so it does impact, as the city manager said, it does impact what we can do overall because we're getting these, you know, we have these other costs that impact the budget. So with that, thank you. And I guess I'd like to open it up to Councilor Knapp. You raised your hand first.
I am not the
school committee experienced person you are, Mr. Chair, but I'll just try to keep my comments general. I'm always confused about the school committee roundtables. Is this being televised?
Yeah.
Okay,
it is not, but Mr. Hawkinson is recorded.
All right, that's fine. Thanks, Mr. Hawkinson. My concern is, if this were in the city council chambers, we now have a rule that says the roundtable should be televised. Is there any reason to believe that the residents and citizens of Cambridge don't want to see this like massive budget discussion on TV right now? Is there
Chair,
any reason we're not doing that?
Mr. Chair, if I may ask for information, I think that, can you correct me or not, this is actually a finance committee meeting that's a joint meeting. Two groups, right? This is in the roundtable.
Well, the call is a roundtable between the city council and the school committee. As the finance chair, I am chairing it. But the original meeting that we had scheduled earlier that got rescheduled to today was actually a finance committee meeting, and then it got switched. Right, so as the mayor has just pointed out to me, the rules of the school committee is that they do not televise roundtables. I guess I would say, your question, do we think the public would not be interested? I mean, no, I think the people are in the public would be interested in this, but I also don't think that there was any ill intent in...
Is that right?
I don't think so.
Okay, because it looks to the public like this is sneaky. We've had a lot of time to change these rules, and I don't understand why something this important to the whole city at $27,000 per student, with some parents complaining that they don't have the educational economic outcomes that they wanted, seems weird to me that we wouldn't televise this and all finance and budget and school committee roundtable meetings.
Chair Madden?
Yes, Madam Mayor.
I think that's an important discussion, but it's not the call of the meeting, and I think we could have an opportunity to discuss this further, but let's use this wonderful opportunity to talk amongst ourselves. That's number one. Number two, roundtables in its early iteration were never televised, and the reason why it was televised was not because we were trying to keep secrets. It was an opportunity for people to comment, if you will, to just kind of do your roll up your sleeves, come casual, to have a discussion. But I think, and I have to give the credit to the co-chairs of the school committee budget, they have had, I can't enumerate as many. So there's no secrets about the budget, and I know this is not your intent, but it almost feels as though you're trying to embarrass the school committee or the council by saying this. And I
am embarrassed.
Well, then you can.
For all of us.
But you don't need to be embarrassed
for
everybody. You know,
is that right?
So,
yes.
So I would just ask
if you
would leave a level of decorum. And if you want to have that discussion, I think it's a great discussion. This is not the proper time.
Sounds good.
If you want to talk about the budget, talk about the budget.
I do want to talk about the budget, so I'll take off my outraged sleeves and put up my rolling up to work sleeves. I just thought that I broached this with enough people.
We're still on the topic.
Advance warning.
Mr. Chair, I think that is not the call of the meeting, and this is really good, important time, and I would respectfully ask that you speak to the budget and not to whether this meeting is open or not. And you're using, this is, you know, the finance chair has done yeoman's work with his colleagues on the other side of the aisle to bring us together. I think this is not the good tenor to start. If you have a disagreement, fine. Let's be disagreeable, but let's not use this time to do that.
And I would just say, Madam Mayor, thank you. You know, there are a lot of things that go into making these decisions, and I don't think it's. I understand that you would prefer to have it televised and done differently, but I do. You know, the accusatory tone that we're doing something sneaky is offensive. So
I brought this up with you before.
Exactly, and I told you.
We didn't have time to plan on this.
Point of order.
And you
are out of order.
And you were not, and Mr. Councilman.
You are out of order.
Councilman Mazin?
You are out of order. You're not chair of this meeting.
Councilman Mazin?
What?
Councilman Mazin, we did have a discussion about it. This is how I decided to run the meeting. If you're accusing me of trying to do something in secret, you know, you are out of line.
Are we done?
I don't know. You tell me.
Sure. I'd like to move on. Thank you.
I made my point, and I think it was a fair point.
Okay. We can disagree on that, too.
Okay. I really appreciated the parts of the superintendent's presentation, the final slide where the bullet point asks, you know, what are expected results, how will they be measured, and when will they occur. I like the slide that that talked about equity to access, support for the whole child, innovation and partnership, implementation and progress monitoring. These are the things that I really hope we can dig deep in. I think the frustration from my perspective, if it wasn't already betrayed by the lack of prior conversation I don't want to revisit, it is that we're spending a lot more than our peers, high-performing school districts across the country, and we're not having the same results. And that's true for school districts that are diverse, school districts that are diverse ethnically, socioeconomically, and otherwise. You are inheriting some of these problems. You're not maybe responsible for them from a historical basis. But they do start and end, I think, with the budget. How does this budget, how do these slides begin to change the game in a formative way? I'm of course, I think, someone who's interested in zero-based budgeting and a start over in some cases for the city budget, maybe not as appropriate for the school budget. So how do the changes FY18 over the FY17 that we met about this time last year, how do they change the game for, let's say, 50% of school-age kids living at into the poverty line who tend to have worse economic outcomes? I guess that could be it for anyone in the school.
Well, I think that's an important question. I think at this stage of the process, we don't have a proposed budget yet. I mean, I can sort of talk conceptually about the idea of having a deliberate process around developing a set of strategic objectives that really identify what are the key priorities as a system. I think is what we know successful high-performing districts do. We know that about successful high-performing countries as well. There's certainly no shortage of data that, you know, without having an intentional plan about how you're prioritizing resources and thinking about how they connect to outcomes for kids, we're not going to get there. I mean, one of the slides I did not share, but one that I do talk a lot about is the idea that, you know, if you are, and I'm paraphrasing, but this notion that, you know, if we're satisfied with the outcomes that we have, there's no need for a strategy because, you know, the system is perfectly designed to get the outcomes that it currently has. So the idea of a strategy is to really set out our vision for what we think are going to be those big bets that are going to create those results. So I think at this stage, you know, that is the goal. I think we don't have a specific proposed budget yet to speak specifically to answer the question, but I think the question is an important one that certainly is how we're thinking about ultimately the results and outcomes for kids.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
Point of information, I'm not sure, Dr. Sling, the emerging priorities, every single one of them are tied directly to the question that Councilor Mazin just asked. It might be useful. I don't know if that makes sense here, but you had presented with us a little more detail on every single one of those emerging priorities directly, you know, social emotional learning, language technology, elementary world language level up. I don't know if that makes sense for this. They haven't heard that since you didn't have time to do in your presentation.
Sure, I can do that. Actually, it's if you look on the, it sort of was part of the backup slides. But yeah, I mean, so as we have thought about the work, this maybe gives a little bit finer grain size to counselors around how we're thinking about the relationship between what are strategic initiatives related to those objectives. So we heard through our roundtable on high school staffing this question on guidance, the ratio of counselors and the supports that students have as they're thinking about college preparation, and also just relationships. And just fundamentally, you know, one of the things that we look at and that we spend some time with our principals and coordinators a couple weeks ago, now was looking at some of our school health survey data around relationships and how much, you know, percentage of students that feel like they have an adult that they can trust, that they can talk to, right? And so, you know, that speaks, you know, to some degree around that. Level up is something that I think probably most, not all counselors have heard at least something about, this idea around how to create more opportunities and access around honors and advanced courses for students. And so what we're planning to do is to have this leveling up or having an honors-only English experience for students in ninth grade starting next year, and then expanding that to social studies in the 18-19 school year. And so we're taking a deliberate effort or staging that to phase it over time. And that really, you know, that I've heard since before officially starting here from many, in many cases from students about who see that underrepresentation of particular Black and Latino students in honors and AP classes. Elementary world language is something we've talked a lot about. We've actually had a couple of presentations for the committee. We had a survey going out to community members and educators around that, another area we've been discussing. We're also looking at phasing in some of our one-to-one technology at the high school to provide access to greater access to technology. Social-emotional learning is something that's certainly a big part of the whole child objective. And thinking about our work here and thinking more concretely about not just how we I want to say social-emotional learning sometimes, and I've shared this before with the school committee, sometimes can serve as almost a catchphrase for a lot of different things. So trying to be very deliberate into defining what we mean by social-emotional learning, what are the competencies that we want our teachers to have as well as students. And then it's about, sort of the tier one, what it means for every student as well as how we're approaching the students that have greater needs. Sometimes I think social-emotional learning becomes a code for the most struggling outlier students who have the most difficult behaviors, and everything we know from research around this work is about prevention and how we have systems and procedures and relationships that support students. The second to last one around recruitment and retention of educators of color is something that has certainly been an area of discussion and focus around at the school committee level as well as with the administration. And the school level tiered support, that last one is about thinking, you know, we talk about response to intervention or RTI, this idea of supports for students at tier one being for all students, tier two for students that need more specialized support, and tier three is being even more specialized in that. We're trying to bring the same approach to thinking about how we're supporting our schools. And at that level of intervention, what does it mean for a district to provide supports for schools? So that's kind of a brief summary of just how we're thinking about some of those emerging priorities that committee member Nolan.
So I also wanted them to say something about the per pupil expenditure, because we hear this all the time. We spend so much more money than everybody else. Why aren't the results better? Money doesn't always correlate to better results. I think there's a question of how we're spending the money. Is it the most effective way to spend it is what they're working on. But the other thing we have to remember is we have a really expensive district. You'd be hard-pressed to find another city that has as many elementary schools of 200, 250 kids that are fully staffed the way we staff them. That's expensive. We have 34 curriculum coaches in our district. Newton, I don't know if it's the same now, but when I was here before and we talked about this, Newton, that is twice our size in enrollment, has 8. So now we can have a question about, do we need 34? What are they doing? Are they effective? That's a whole other conversation. But when all that gets averaged into what the per pupil expenditure is, and so, you know, we have a really we have an expensive district. We don't, every school has coaches. Every school has guidance counselors or social workers and guidance counselors and psychologists and principals and assistant principals and family liaisons, at least in the elementary schools. All of that costs a lot of money. So is that the best use of the money? Could it be used better? I mean, that's another conversation. But I think that's a big part of that per pupil expenditure is, if we closed 4 schools and had elementary schools of 500 or 600 kids, there'd be more money in a lot of areas. But that's not what this community really values in terms of having small schools where every child is known and every child is supported. So that's an important piece of figuring out that per pupil expenditure.
What I'd love to see then as part of the next meeting, if the school committee can provide it, is just a pictograph representation of how a pupil's cost breaks down. What are the different things flowing into that pupil, and how does that compare to the cities that we like to compare ourselves to, just to understand what we're doing better and different. And then ideally, I guess, that would jive with the implementation and progress monitoring. If we're putting certain types of funding into each pupil that are over and above what other districts might do, or even logistically just a matter of how we structure our district, it would be great to know that we're actually getting the intended output on the other side.
And I would say the other part of this, because I don't want to put this all on the schools. You know, when you look at the achievement gap, my opinion is the achievement gap starts before kids even enter the Cambridge public schools. So that's on us, on the city side, in a lot of ways around early childhood education and what we're funding. What happens after school? What happens around poverty, housing, food? Those are all things that every child and family that are struggling with those issues bring to the schools, and then we ask the schools to fix all that. And when they can't, and a child doesn't perform as well on a test that we can debate the test all night long too, we say, oh, the schools are failing. Well, you know, that's not always fair. And I'm not saying that you're saying it, but that is the perception of, gee, we spend all this money and these kids don't do as well. Well, part of that isn't the school's fault.
I'm actually saying something different and potentially much scarier, which is that even in the best performing school districts and even out of the best universities, there's a common understanding that today's graduates will struggle in the workforce to make as much as their parents. And if you're not in upper management, you will have a stagnant wage. You'll start and you'll just be flat forever. These are the people who are lucky. The people who are unlucky will have, you know, wages that don't beat inflation and a whole host of other factors. So I guess what I'm saying is how do we, in our mutual goal to prepare people for a workforce and a life that's guided by passion and success and economic benefit and all these other things, how do we relate the extra money we're putting in to the actual tangible outcome? Hopefully, totally separate from the exam performance and maybe more qualitatively judged by our out-of-school programs, internship placements, job and college survey results, and other things like that.
I know Councilor Chung is chomping at the bit, but
I also want
to make sure I mix it up a little bit, too.
I'll yield to a school committee.
Mr. Chair, just one quick clarification. I just want to be clear. So, Councilor Mazin, I understand him trying to break down in the pictograph or whatever it is the actual per pupil expenditure. I just want to be clear to the public that school funding, and I agree with him that it's a good way to kind of gauge, you know, exactly what where the resources are going. I totally agree. But just to be clear, it's a little more complicated, and it's not an apples-to-apples comparison, although the formula works for accounting, meaning that we may have a student, for instance, that, quite frankly, you know, I think we might assume that it's $110,000 for that particular student, right? So I understand what you're saying, but just know that the per pupil expenditure and the formula that we use is one that we use in settings like this. When you go from school to school and think about the resources, you could have a couple of students with particular high needs that, and you're just thinking of your pictograph, that you know, take up a lot of resources because that's what they need. And so I just want to be clear to the public, and I know that you aren't asserting anything different, that the per pupil expenditure, while it's there, it doesn't always tell the exact story of a school or what a principal with a particular population, quite frankly, is dealing with when they're delegating their resources within a building. So I just want to say that.
And my response would be, if we can just still do the project, what one would typically do in a situation like that is bin the different types of students. Here's the students we spend 50 to 80. They kind of look the same in the sense of how we fund them. Like if you look at the pictograph of how we fund people in that range, it's a similar type of funding that goes into that bin. If the student's getting 20 to 30, they're in the largest bin, and we're funding those students a certain way that looks like this in the pictograph. I would still love to see the breakdown. I recognize that it might be a nuanced breakdown. But nonetheless, it's still potentially a very informational one and one that can be used to judge progress and future investment.
Michelle?
Oh. Thanks. I just want to start out thanking you all in the city for the funding increase. It's really helpful to all of us. I won't Just that last update was that we were going to be able to both continue with our existing staffing and yet do some new initiatives. Just to note, anyone who wants to can go to the state. There is a very detailed state spending per pupil expenditure by about 27 different categories. You can compare to every single district across the state. And that state spending report includes what I think you referenced, Mr. Chair, which is the city spending on behalf of the schools. So the state spending, the DESE, Department of Elementary and Secondary Education per pupil spending, includes all the city spending that goes to the schools as well. So it's actually pretty good apples to apples, and it goes down to the level of about 30 different categories. Now, does that say whether the coaches are effective? Does that say whether our school size is effective at building relationships? No, but at least it gives you a good sense. I just wanted to make two points, taking you up on your offer of saying what would be really helpful for us. As someone who lives in West Cambridge, as Madam Budget Co-Chair Kelly referenced, the building definitely affects us, and I don't think there's a strong commitment from the city to build a school right now in the quad, and if there should be an early education center and a school building. Our enrollment's growing. We have a very geographically disparate spread of the schools, that there's right now at least more students living on the west side of Cambridge and fewer seats there than there are on the east side. As you said, even there's several thousand more units going up in LF. Even if 100 of them have kids, it's going to be another half school or school. And there's already a lot of kids in that part of town who would ordinarily maybe choose a school in that area, and they can't do it. So I definitely hope, and I don't know how to convey that other than having all of you be really clear that that area, which is right now in the process of planning, really needs to have a school. And the second point, tying together the early education, I think this is something we can use your continuing to push that early education work. We got an update on it recently to make sure that that continues on. I do think it's a city function. You know, while we can help contribute, that 0 to 4 is really something that that I hope we continue to build and would like to see both centers developed and also, you know, robust programming that combines the work that's already being done on professional development for family daycare and others. We're not talking about getting rid of those, but we're talking about increasing the quality. So thanks.
Thank you. Councilor Trump.
Thanks, Cassandra. I guess, I think you guys need new mics. I think a few things, just to respond to the most recent discussion before I get back to the broader topic. I think, you know, the schools, like, are, I think, similar to the city of Cambridge in that we don't do a great job of talking about all the things we're doing. Like, you know, I mention human services a lot. The depth of resources and certain programs within the department are just, you know, it's astounding once you start making use of them. But they're not all super well known. I think the schools as well, you know, the cost of education, you know, I agree on the top line point that, you know, I'm not satisfied with what we're getting for our money. I would probably never be satisfied no matter what we're getting for. I think we can always do better. But you know, the cost of the school is not really. It's hard to. You know, there's a lot of nuance even within the state. For example, you know, if you do a sport in Cambridge, you're not going to pay for your equipment. You know, I think I have friends who recently moved. You know, on the state site, it says Cambridge full day pre-K, Newton full day pre-K. What they don't say on the site is that Newton, 3 of the 4 days are early release days, so it's really like 8 to noon. Whereas, you know, I'm going the full day every single day. You know, that's I think a pretty big difference. So there's a lot of areas where Cambridge goes above and beyond for students, I think all those things add up and they're all worthwhile. But we don't do a great job of talking about why is it that our per pupil cost is higher than other districts. I think there's very good reasons that it is, but we don't have, you know, I don't. I think that the data is necessarily going to tell us that what we're doing is wrong, but I think it's going to say we're spending a lot of money on a lot of things that matter. But I think an accounting of those things, I think it would be useful for the city side to do an accounting of all the things that we do that are great. I think the CIS schools would benefit from that as well. You know, I think just recently, just quickly to the West Cambridge, the quadrangle, I think given all the construction we're doing in near terms, compromise might be like let's build Tobin a bit bigger. We know we're especially if we get the armory next door and expand the campus there. I think we have an ability to make a really great campus when we rebuild the Tobin. So, you know, so going back to the broad thing, I want to really thank the vice mayor and the mayor for having this. As a city councilor, I'm not trying to get into the weeds in terms of dictating education policy, but I am trying to support what the school committee is doing. And even, you know, though it, you know, by charter, I'm not responsible for education. That's one of the things as an elected official I'm often asked the most about. I think it's something that, that parents are the most interested in. And I think, you know, I've been wanting for years to have discussion before the budget to try and talk about ways that we can support the initiatives of the schools and try to get to, I think, the vision we have in terms of all the issues we want to have for the money that we're spending. You know, and just to name a few, so I, you know, what just to kick this up for conversation, would, you know, I would, it's not clear to me how I would say, like, I would love to give you more money if, for a few things that were, like, would just be on the top of my bucket list. I think that food, you know, we should not charge for school lunches. You know, I get Facebook messages from my cafeteria worker in my school saying, oh, Leela ate this today, and she had this experience. It's amazing. I would love for her to just be interacting with students all day and not worried about having the kid type in this, like, 10-digit PIN in order to get their lunch. I don't even know how they memorize it, but it's crazy. Like, so if you're typing the numbers, it's this long number, so you're having to sit there, process the kids. Just go eat the food. Like, we have really healthy food. Eat as much of it as you put in your mouth. You know, like, it's great. I think it's relatively inexpensive for us to just fund the lunches for every single student, so we're not going to help address food insecurity. And you can repurpose the people who are right now just being acting as cashiers to do what they're really, I think, incredibly valuable is interacting with the students and making sure they're eating and opening, like, you know, opening up those juice boxes is very difficult for a 3-year-old. They're walking around helping do that. I would love them to do more of that. I think foreign language, you know, I know there's been a lot. I don't know how much is in the press that I'm reading is accurate reflection of what's going on in the discussion with the school committee. But I think language is incredibly important, both the world language and the immersion program. I know tons of parents who wait to see if they get into the Mandarin immersion program, and when they don't get into it, they're leaving the district. Like, they want it, and the same thing with the Amigos. People want to come here for language. I think every parent recognizes it's an important thing. I think it's critical in, you know, 21st century. And frankly, you know, you can talk about the disparities that it's creating within, like, you know, we're getting kids who have proactive parents, the ability to get into this program and lobby for it, and it's giving them a leg up. They're advocating for it because they see the value of it. Let's just give it to every single student. Why don't we have immersion for every single student in the district? I would love to talk about how we can make that happen, what it would cost, and see that become a reality. It would be amazing if every single student graduating from CRLS was fluent or conversant in Mandarin. I think that would give them a huge leg up in the world. That's one. Second one, third one, pre-K. You know, as I said before, this is one of those frustrating things for me. It's great that we're doing this, that we're doing the research, that we have a report coming back to us. I feel like it's the biggest runaround ever. You know, and all due respect to, I think, school committee woman Nolan, you know, in terms of it being a city responsibility, the schools already do great pre-K. It's fantastic. My daughter's in it. It's a great program. Like, let's just scale it up. We already know how to do pre-K. We don't need to study it. We don't need to talk about it. Like, we can just copy exactly what we're doing at the Tobin School, give that to every single student, every single school in Cambridge. Like, we know how to do it. It's working phenomenally well. I don't see why we need to talk about pre-K at all when we know exactly what to do. We can just copy and paste that throughout the district. You know, if we have to fund more schools, if we have to fund the swing space, we, like, you know, rebuild on Broadway, whatever it needs to do. I think every kid should be getting that. I think the last, those are my top three in terms of just a careful discussion about how we can work collaboratively with you to try and think about programs like the layer on to that could really have a beneficial impact. And there's a lot more that I won't go into. You know them all. I think this is a little bit more of my parent head on the strategic objectives that you put out as compared to the emerging priorities. You know, I participated in the School Advisory Council had the program that you initiated, envisioning what your kid is like graduating from CRLS in, you know, not long enough of a time. It should be longer than, you know, I wish you wouldn't graduate for 40, 50 years. but, you know, I do feel like as you can see this going from the emerging priorities to the strategic objectives, the moral good crowds out, I think, more of the tactical things that I want to see happen. For example, when I was in that process, people were talking about, I want to have someone who has cultural competency or cultural humility. You know, I want my child to be, you know, confident and self-realized and, you know, an independent learner. I want my daughter to know math. I don't want my daughter to grow up to be a woman. I just heard this on the NPR today. Grows up a woman and says, oh, math is not my thing. Math is everyone's thing. You know, every child should grow up and graduate with a solid proficiency in math, solid proficiency in, you know, financial, personal finance. You know, I said also at the thing, I said, you know, every kid when they graduate from CRLS should know the basics of coding. They should know how to code. And parents were like every kid? I'm like, well, what do you mean? Who should not graduate, learn how to code? And when our students are graduating from CRLS in 10 to 20 years, coding is going to be the same as we see email today. If you are a professional and you don't know how to do open Outlook and do email, you're not taking it very seriously. In the future, if you don't know how to do the basics of, you know, script or put together some kind of automation, that's the where the world is going. We need to prepare every single kid to know the basics of coding. And you see that with, like, the one-to-one technology. That's fantastic. I think we've been talking for years about, you know, making sure that every kid has a laptop. We went through this big thing when Mayor Davis was around that the kids can get on the computers at the library. It's fantastic. We're giving them all Chromebooks now. But they also need to know the background of that. I don't just want them to be consumers of technology. I want them to be producers of technology so that our students have a competitive advantage against kids across the entire world. And I think we need to see our Cambridge public schools as preparing kids to compete globally with anybody. You know, you need to stack them up against any kid from any country, and they need to be better than them. Because, you know, the people that we have here, this is the melting pot. We have people from all around the world, which is great. But, you know, we're an increasingly competitive world, and I want my daughter not just to be self-realized and independent and confident. I want her to be able to have a job and be able to go out and make a great living and have all the skills that build that confidence. So I want to, you know, I agree with all the moral good and I want all those things, but I don't want that to crowd out the discussion about the very tactical reality. Like, I want her to know math. I want her to know the language. I want her to know English. I want to make sure that those things aren't forgotten when we're talking about, I think, all the higher level stuff that seems to dominate the discussion these days. That's about 2 cents. Thanks.
Thank you. Ms. Dexter.
Thanks. Are we not using the first names for a roundtable?
We will do.
Great. Thanks, Mark. First of all, I want to thank you. Thomas. I prefer that. Thank you to Louie and Gina and the whole budget team for the increases here. It really is something that parents have been advocating for over a long time, and I think we're going to use the money well. It doesn't mean that we're not going to make cuts anywhere. I'm sure we'll try to figure out how to shift money away around to make sure that we're using it efficiently. And I really appreciate all the comments from Leland and Nadim and Patty. Also, thank you so much. It's really helpful to hear from the council about what your ideas are from the school. I don't see it as micromanaging it. I don't see it as critical. I see it, you all, as our partners. We are all educating the same kids because your city departments are educating our kids, our families. We're educating the same kids and families, and we don't want the same thing. In terms of, Nadim, your question about why are other districts getting better results and spending less, I'm not really sure who those districts are. I don't really know, and you could, you know, I know that there are some districts that sometimes on some years in some grades get better test scores than we do, and other years in other grades they get worse scores than we do. There are some districts that have difficult graduation rates. There are different districts that are successful in different areas, but I don't know any one district that is successful with populations that are expensive and difficult to educate, which is primarily either students with disabilities or students who are economically disadvantaged in some way, or students who have English language issues. So if you could find one of those districts and tell me who's doing a much better job, I think any kid, no matter what your circumstances are, you're generally better off in Cambridge than almost any district in the state on a lot of measures, maybe not every single one, but I think kids are lucky to go to school here with what we have. I would be remiss if I didn't mention to the city manager and to the council that the Amigos school building is inadequate and too small for them. So we need to be thinking about a new building for the Amigos or new facilities. In terms of, Nadim, your question about could you see a pictograph, I just happen to have one here. So I always make notes for these types of things, so I made a set of budget notes for you all. And I went to what, spent a couple of days doing this because this is what I enjoy doing, one of the things I wanted to be on the committee. But if you get these notes and you turn to page 4, I took the data that Patty referenced from DESC, and I basically compared our school district to Brookline, what we spend in each of the categories that DESC breaks us down as spending. They have, I won't go through all these notes today, obviously, we don't have enough time, but you can take these home and read them. They have about, 8 or 12 different categories. And you can see that we spend more than Brookline in almost every category. They spend about $17,000 per kid. We spend about $27,000 per kid. But what's interesting is the biggest difference, and I really don't understand this, and maybe this is something that the budget team can help me understand, is the biggest difference is how much we spend on insurance, pensions, and benefits. So if you look at page 4, that top graph, I hope there's enough for most everybody there. This is what we have from DESE. And this is for the most recent date, which is 2015. And if it's too small, I can give you a better copy sometime. But if you just look across those bar graphs, you'll see that we're higher on everything. We're the blue and Brookline is the red. But there's an enormous difference between what we spend in pension and insurance as compared with Brookline. I don't really understand that. I don't know if it's because we used to have a very large school system and many more teachers and staff, and all those teachers and staff are pensioned now, and our school system has shrunk, and so per pupil, it looks like a lot more than districts like Brookline that were never as large as we were. But that's about $4,000 of that $10,000 difference between us and Brookline. The next page has a, it's $3,300 per student more than us. So that's the biggest category, the difference us between Brookline. And the next biggest category is what's called non-educational pupil services, which is stuff like buses. We spend a lot of money, and here's another issue about how we cost share with the city. Controlled choice benefits our schools, but it benefits our entire city. This is part of the city goal of diversity and integration. But the school district, when we talk about who's bearing the cost, it all goes into the city budget. These are really high costs that other cities don't have because they don't have a controlled choice program. Some Boston does, et cetera. So that's another reason why we have a high cost. As Mark said, our small schools are very, very expensive. They're unprecedented. I looked at the average elementary school in Massachusetts has 400 students. In our district, the average is about 265 students per elementary school and upper school. All of our schools are under the state average. And that's expensive for two reasons. One, a large school is almost the cost of a small school in terms of administration, et cetera. We also have a lot of empty seats because we have to run a third grade with 14 kids in it because we only have 28 kids, and we can't run it with 28 kids, so we have to break it up. So those empty seats, by my calculation, is adding $2,000 per student. Now I'm a little bit uncertain about that, but I have to go back. But that's the numbers that I ran. Is empty seats, unfilled seats, just in JK to 5 costs us a lot of extra money. That's neither here nor there, but they are explanations for why our system is so expensive. If you go through this document, those are budget details. If you turn to the next page, it talks about, I think what we're all really concerned about are the gaps, because we educate a lot of kids well, but there are a lot of kids we are not educating well. And so this just gives you all... I'm sorry. When people are talking, it's hard for me to talk. So this just gives you basic information on our recent PARC scores, and our graduation college-going rate. You can just see what it is that we're trying to solve. It's a big gap. It's the gap that you see everywhere in this country. It's not easy to solve. We don't know how to. Well, we have a lot of good advice. The next part talks about what the advice is on how to solve those gaps, and a lot of the advice has to do with classroom staffing and school-based staffing. In Brookline, we only spend about 9% more than Brookline on our core teachers. So we spend a lot more on other things, but we don't spend a lot more than Brookline on our core teachers. Brookline spends 40% of their budget on classroom and specialist teachers. We only spend 28% of our budget on classroom and specialist teachers. So I see that as a place to really put our energy. It's reducing class sizes, double staffing some of our classrooms, having more reading specialists, etc. And then the next section prices some of that out for you. It says, what would it cost a wish list of additional CPS staffing? This is where I cost out for you what it would take. And this is where the city council could think about whether you want to give us money for food, you want to give us money for more social workers, etc. This is what it would cost for what I consider to be better staffing for what we need. And then the last page are things that we have in our budget that really overlap a lot with DHS functions. And these things are things that other school departments would not provide. So, for example, we have to rent a building for our administration. That costs us $309,000 a year, or $306,000. Most school departments don't have to rent their administrative building. We have out-of-school time partners that overlap and function with DHS. We have preschools that most school departments don't run. You know, the extra busing. Our many, many buildings are used by other departments, and yet we incur all the maintenance and operations and staffing costs for those things. So those just give you an idea of why all the expenses in our budget that are not related to our core function of education. And I think if you went into the police and fire department, you'd find that most of the expenses in their budget are related to their core functions of policing and fire. Police do have some other social service programs, et cetera, but most of their budget is focused on their core function. And that's not necessarily true here. And that's good, because we have extra things, but it does cost us money.
Thank you, Emily. Just real quick, just so we're clear, because I don't want anyone getting the wrong idea. When you say if the council wants to give the school committee or the school department more money for social workers and whatnot, I just want to remind folks we do not have line item authority. So, you know, I'm going to make a few comments at the end about sort of, I have some thoughts around food, and we've been doing some work on this too. But at the end of the day, even
I didn't mean that.
Yeah. No, I just want to, we have reporters and we have people out there. I just want to make sure people know that, you know, even if the council were to say and the manager were to say, here's $1 million and we hope it goes towards X, that's really a decision that you guys have to make, not us.
Thank you. I understand that.
Kathleen. Okay, Kathleen is next.
I just wanted to speak to the expense of some of the more vulnerable kids in the district, and this is really talking about the Office of Student Supports, because we've had, you know, a major, and I don't have the figures right in front of me, but we have had a major jump, as have many of the school districts in the state, and out-of-district tuition. And a lot of that is related to the fact that a number of our students and a number of young people are experiencing, one, mental health challenges. So when you look at the root cause analysis of what's going on with the Office of Student Support, that's one major group, and that is the expense of going to therapeutic private schools. And the other is we have a number of students who not only have disabilities but also have complex medical needs and need to be in very complex environments, and we are required to pay the tuition for that according to law. And it's Cambridge is generous in terms of dealing with what is considered those that the top small number at the top, because I always get mixed up on the tier one's the bottom, tier two. But the top three, which is a relatively small number of students, but is a large expense for the district. And then also generally involved with that is transportation expense. And then there's also expenses related to Medicaid and other areas that, depending on if it's with the Department of Children and Families, and so there's complex relationships there. So I just wanted to shed just sort of a little light on what's going on with that particular line item. And so the transportation expense also goes up as well, because those students are transported door to door from home to whatever school they're attending, or hospital, or wherever they, you know, hospitalized school environment, or they're going to Perkins or other programs. But it's also a civil rights issue that we, you know, it's required by law to provide the services, that the access to services and access to education to every student. So I just wanted to comment on that in particular.
Thank you. And Richard, before I go to you, Richard, Patty, and Fred will probably have
flashbacks to what I'm about to say because I said it a million times when I sat in this room.
I'm
going to put on my hat as someone who's worked in therapeutic schools and had kids involved in therapeutic schools for 25 years. I work with school districts all across Massachusetts, and I never want Cambridge to make a decision on what is the appropriate placement for a child because of my, based on money. I've sat in way too many meetings with school districts that have said, go ahead, take us to court, sue us, we're not paying for that, even though they know it's the right thing to do. Now, does that mean Cambridge always agrees? Maybe the parent wants an outplacement and the school says, no, we don't think it's necessary. That's different, but it's never about money in any meeting that I've sat in. And so we should be proud of that. Because we're making decisions based on what is actually in the best interest of the child, not what is in the best interest of our bottom line. So it makes me proud that we're spending money for out-of-district placements if that is truly what the child needs.
I'd also just like to quickly follow back to Kathleen.
I just wanted to also make the point that it has literally saved students' lives.
Yeah.
So could I just briefly respond to your point now, I would like us to have the same attitude toward all students. So when it comes to class size, social workers in the schools, I don't want to say we are not going to have appropriately small class sizes because of money. We are not going to have enough social workers because of money. I think we ought to be treating the same, all students the same way. Every student gets what they need, no matter what their circumstances are. Thank you.
Mr. Harden, or Richard.
Yeah, thank you. Mr. Harden is good for me.
Okay. Thank you.
So I think, and it's a good conversation, but I think what we're doing is taking on the tough conversation about values, quite frankly. Because the truth is, and we've said this in different meetings, if we were Lawrence or another district, we'd be forced to do some of the things that Chairman McGovern talked about. And then there would be a certain outcry throughout the city around the compassion or lack thereof that we have. And so I think that while we're having these conversations and there is some conflict, the truth is that our system has always been, and most likely will continue to be, based on the values that are espoused by the citizenry. And that's why we are here. Right. There's no doubt that the model, if we were a business, right, this model is super expensive. Mm-hmm. You cannot, nowhere else would you have in a city like this, a school with 265 kids in it. But within that school, we're talking about having many more boots on the ground, more than other districts, smaller, more individualized attention to the student. These are decisions that we make. And these decisions, fortunately, I would say, as Mr. McGovern said, do take money and resources. And so if we're really going to have a conversation ever about the money, which for me, for my money, for every vote that I got, I would take every single cent we have. I just would want to make sure that more kids are getting an excellent education. I wouldn't give the money back at all, because I think it's well worth it. This is the investment we should have. It's all about values. And so if we're not going to change our values, or if our values aren't consistent with what we think we should be doing in our schools, we should have that conversation. I just want to say just one thing as a point of fact, that I do like to, in every committee I've been on, someone has talked about Brookline and Cambridge. I don't think it's quite the comparison that it's all made up to be. I'm not discounting the work. I just think that it's little apples to oranges more than apples to apples, in my opinion. What I would say is this. Let's just use the simple math. Brookline, we have more employees, cost more money. We have a better insurance system, we pay more for it. I would think the city manager can chime in on this. We have a fully funded pension system, right? Full-time, full dental. We do this because we care. And so I don't discount any of the conversations. I think they're good conversations to have. I would say, though, I rarely speak to a parent who's in the district and they're worried about how much money we're spending. They're more worried about what their kid's getting or they're not getting, and that's the conversation we should be having. But when you think about these things, you know, people cost money, the top insurance, all that stuff costs money. So I would just simply say that at some point we may be forced to have a conversation about the values that we have, right? Do we want to continue to have school choice where you take a kid from the Alwife and send them to the Amigos or run Upton Street, right? That's a value decision. It's controlled choice, but we have to think about how we go about these things. And so I just want us, and I think Chairman McGovern, you said it, that we can either do this and and aspire to be a district that has compassion for our most vulnerable and serve all of our kids to the point that it prepares them for an excellent education. I know my kid got it. I thank you. I clap for you all because my daughter got an excellent education in the public schools. So I commend you all for any little part you may have had. And I know plenty of parents like that. At the same time, we understand that there are kids that don't necessarily realize that same educational experience. And so I think that's how we have to think about this. We could make decisions like Lawrence, like Holyoke, right, that, trust me, our constituents would have a whole different take on how we're governing the city. And so I think this is a great conversation, but remember, our values, the things that we care about, they're expensive. And so I like the conversation, but I just want to make sure that we stay grounded in the fact that I think those values are good for us. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Councilor Deborah.
Thank you, everyone. This has been really interesting. I am relatively new to talking about school budgets, so I'm learning a lot. I would have loved to have had some of these materials in advance just to be able to look at them, because when people start throwing numbers around, I have to be looking at them, and it helps to have looked at them in advance. Maybe I'm one of those people who didn't get a strong enough math education in school. And I agree with Leland on a lot of the points that he made. I think it will be super important for all students to learn coding. And I think, I know that we're struggling to figure out how to integrate world language into the elementary schools. Coding is going to be another one of those things where we're going to have to get creative to figure out how to bring that into the curriculum without taking time away from other things, how to basically introduce coding into English classes. There are ways to do that. Schools are already doing that. One that I worked at, in fact, was doing that, not the charter school. I totally agree with the comments about pre-K and early childhood education, because I think, Mark, you're absolutely right that the achievement gap starts way before the kids get into school. And so, in a sense, if we don't address it early on, we're just continuing to pour money into a problem that we can't solve. And we're never going to solve it entirely. I mean, let's be honest. We can close it, but we may never solve it entirely. That's just the reality, because we can't control everything in the schools. There's a lot going on outside of schools. I would love to see these immersion programs in every school. I don't know what that would take. I also would love to see the school lunches be free. I think that is something that is pretty doable. My understanding was that the federal government was actually trying to facilitate that, but I don't. I remember when I worked at the charter school, they were talking about doing that, and it was going to be possible. But I,
that pre the dark era.
The dark era of the other dark. Yeah. Yes, you're right. That was before November 8th. As it relates to the Tobin, which is right around the corner from my house, I think, on the one hand, I can see, we're talking about a project that could start construction within 3 years. So, it would be great to acquire the Armory. It would be great to acquire the Tokyo restaurant, expand our whole empire for that whole, get rid of the gas stations, and, we'll just be right on Frick Pond. I don't know how realistic that is. So I also have been participating a lot in the Envision Cambridge process, particularly as it relates to Alewife, and struggling with how to make the Quad a neighborhood. And so I think, obviously a school is a logical anchor to have over there. So, I think if we're talking about population, one of the frustrating things with those exercises, with the scenarios for the planning, is that population is never mentioned. We always talk about units. We can have, this scenario will give us potentially 4,000 new units of housing, and we never talk about the people who are living in those units. And, the choices that you make, even in the mix of unit sizes, has an impact. And the quality of the neighborhood has an impact of who wants to live there. At the moment, it's probably not a family's first choice of a place to go and live. And I don't know
if what we can do with the planning over the very long term will eventually make it a place where people say, yeah, applaud, that's where I want to raise my four kids and, you know, and put down roots. I don't know if it'll be that way, but I think we need to figure out if that's what we're going for and what we need to create that experience. I agree with Emily that small classrooms, I mean, we talk about small schools, but it doesn't look like our class sizes are incredibly small. And so is it better to have a larger school, save some money that way, have 400 kids in a school, but to have smaller class sizes and to take that school and, you know, make it have smaller groups, you know, cohorts, you know, because it's not really the building we're talking about, it's the relationships, and you can create relationships if you have enough adults and you have the right approach. So, you know, the relationships, you have to have a low ratio, you also have to have guidance and advisory systems, particularly in the high school, and I really think that handicaps our high school students not having a good guidance staff. Another random thought, let's see. I would be interested in seeing enrollment projections. I mean, I think it's great that enrollment's going up. I don't know exactly, again, this ties in with the LWAC thing, what is our population going to be in 10 years, and is our average age going to continue to fall? I think our average age right now is like in the low 30s or something citywide. You know, and how many people in their low 30s have children, and what will happen in 10 years? Are all of those people, will they be able to find housing? Will they leave? You know, what? As our population grows, do we anticipate the student population growing, or basically not growing as fast as the population? All those questions are really important. And then I wanted to just to make a comment in relation to what I think Emily talked about, which is that we spend a lot of money on things that are not the core function of schools. And that's absolutely true, and that ties back to what Richard was saying about values, because we put in a lot of things that we think and we believe are important to schools that aren't classroom education. But I think, you know, she mentioned the police force. The police force is doing a whole bunch of stuff, you know, with community policing initiatives that aren't really what we used to think policing was. So I think, in a sense, education is a much, you know, it's changed a lot. We're teaching a lot of different skills. The socio-emotional, all that other stuff was something that 50 years ago, when I was in school, no one talked about. So you got that at home, or you didn't get it at all. So it's a really interesting conversation. I support what the manager said about the need for the $10 million, and I'd be interested to see what that works out to on a per-student basis. I know it's not a precise number, but it's still interesting. So thank you, everyone.
Thank you. I want to acknowledge also Councillor Toomey, who's here, Councillor Carlone next, and then we'll go to Tim if you have any thoughts. We do have about 15 minutes. I want to make some comments at the end. I think the mayor may want to say a few things. So
I only need 25 minutes, so it'll work out fine. No, I'll be brief. First of all, I think the discussion has really been interesting, and I always love hearing passion, people caring about the subject. Just a few thoughts. One, as an urban design architect, you never build a neighborhood without a school, a library, a park. We might think of it that way, but we don't. Studies have shown that. They've also shown that schools in the range of what Cambridge schools are the ones that build the most community, 200 to 250, I've read. Is that... Now, granted, these are neighborhood schools, so it's a little bit different. North Point, when I originally did the city work for North Point, I wanted to put a school there, and I was told no. Well, those were during downtimes. I could kind of understand that. There's no doubt in my mind Alewife needs a school, as people have said, a pre-primary facility as well, and probably two residential squares. If you don't have that, it'll never be a neighborhood. It'll always be a transitional spot. People with families will tend not to congregate there. My son, when he was here, my older son was in physics, and I loved physics when I was in high school. And it kind of made sense because I went on to architecture. But I was disappointed that he didn't like it. And the reason he didn't like it is he didn't know what it would lead him to. So a couple years later, he went to study video game design in college. And as my fellow co-chair said, it's all physics. And I get this phone call, and he said, "Papa, I want to buy another textbook." And I love books, so I, sure, what is it? And he said, "It's a really cool physics book." And I fell out of my chair. And the reason is he understood how physics related to his interest. And if that had happened in high school, I know he would have gotten more involved. And that link of different subjects connecting to something inside of us made all the difference for him. And lastly, I mentioned this, I think, the last time we met. My wife and I were part of the Say Yes to Education program, which worked with kids from the old Harrington School who were at the bottom of the list as far as achievement, family income, you name it. And people from Leslie and a foundation helped pay for this. For 15 years, those kids had extra attention for after-school summer programs, enrichment programs, support at home. And those kids did amazingly well. Two-thirds went on to college, and I think the expectation was 20%. If this enrichment program didn't happen. So to me, what I learned there, and I saw these kids blossom with this extra attention and care, Katie and I were an aunt and uncle that followed them along, that made all the difference. And if we could do that for the kids at the bottom of the pack. Oh, and lastly, really lastly, preschool. Totally agree with all the preschool comments. It was my thesis. And I know many of you know this. Half of what kids learn, they learn before they come into kindergarten. It's pretty obvious what we have to do. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilor Toomey, anything you want to
say? Oh, Fred, hey. Sorry, the dean,
man. Oh, no, that's all right. Thank you. I'll be quick. I enjoyed the conversation and the councilor's honesty. I think you've really made it clear what your priorities are, and I appreciate that. I just want to basically say that, you know, with a new superintendent, with a new city manager, I think there's a real sense of optimism and hope and energy that I think is really moving us forward. The city manager at his State of the City address, you know, said that he was going to provide us with the resources to do an excellent job, and shortly thereafter provided us with one of the biggest increases in resources that we've ever had. He could have taken a much more conservative approach. He could have squeezed us, forced us to try to make some cuts, to do some other things that would have really not put us on the path of allowing the superintendent to move forward with his entry plan and his anticipated strategic plan coming before us. You know, he chose to give us a very generous resources. And I, like the city manager, believe that there really is only one budget in the city of Cambridge. And the bottom line is whether we have the resources to do our job or not. And to be honest with you, when I attend national conferences all across this country, you know, Cambridge is known as the poster child for more resources than any other school system. So we have the resources to do an excellent job. The resources that the manager has given us provides us with those resources. And I am going to rely on the superintendent with his experience to tell us what the best levers are to improve our education. Some may think it's reducing class size. The superintendent may have some different levers that he feels are going to take us to a better place. So I'm even going to rely on his experience to tell us what levers are best to improve education. But I feel that we're in a very optimistic position to move forward. I think we're probably one of the highest urban performing districts in the state, and we know we can do better, and we're going to do better. And so the only thing I would ask from the city council, and it's just a tiny thing, is, you know, the Department of Human Services provides, you know, the college success program. They provide Baby University. They provide well over $1 million in special needs staff for after-school programs. So, you know, they're providing things that I would argue that the school department should be doing. But they've saw a need, and they've jumped in, and they've filled it. And that's the stuff that I appreciate about the working relationship we have. The fact that we have three new schools coming is because we have spent a lot of time intentionally developing collaboration and a spirit of cooperation with everybody over the last, I've been here for the 35 years that Louie has been here. And I think that collaboration shouldn't be taken for granted. It is something that you have to work hard at every single day. But the benefits of that should not be, you know, minimized by folks. Where, you know, the city council could have easily voted to spend a lot of capital money redoing public works. They chose, and thank goodness, to renovate our schools, which I think is just one example of putting your money where your mouth is, and that's $330 million. But the only thing I would say is that I do think the Amigo School needs a solution. Don't know what that is, but I hope we can find one. And I will say on a little thing is, you know, Mr. Toomey and I and many others, we've gone to like Bunker Hill Community College and stuff, and there really is a need to provide some of our students with small costs that get them through college, like bus passes that they can't afford to, things that end up being a real obstacle from kids going to college. So I hope at some point we can talk about supporting some of those kids, but that would be my only thought. Thank you.
Thank you. I thought, Mr. Fantini, I thought you were going to say when we build that new school in the quad, we call it the Fred Fantini Elementary School.
But I'm still trying to get a bathroom named after me.
I'm going to make a few comments, then I'm going to turn it to the mayor. We're coming close. I want to make sure everybody... No, don't give me this. I want to make sure everybody has a chance to say something before we go back. In terms of the question about our buildings, you know, this is something that Councilor Kelly, who was here earlier, talks about a lot. We don't actually have a great idea of who lives in these buildings. So, you know, if you look at the number, as Jan said, you look at the number of people that are now moving into the city, and it would be easy to say, yes, we need a school. But we actually don't know how many of those kids are school-age kids and how many aren't. So I think we have to get, that's important information for us to have, because that should drive our decision. If it really turns out that, yes, there are enough kids, then that's a different conversation. So I don't think we actually have a great understanding of that. In terms of class size, you know, that's a debatable... I mean, I think everybody sort of agrees that, like, 40 kids is too many. But, you know, one of the problems we had in our old system when we were a K-8 is we had some classes that had 11 kids in them. That wasn't good either, right? Kids got a lot of attention, but there wasn't a robust cohort of kids to get a lot of experience. So, you know, you look at the Montessori model, that those are, they want larger class sizes in that model. So, you know, 20 kids, 17 kids, 18 kids, 21 kids, I mean, who knows, right? I mean, I think, you know, it's hard to say. It makes a difference as to who those kids are. So it's not, we got to look beyond sort of the number and say, yeah, we're doing a good job with this or we're not. It's more complicated than that. The other issue around achievement, you know, I think one of the things that we struggle with here is right now, for better or worse, and I tend to think it's worse, the measure that people use are MCAS scores, right? But one of the things I've said often is that, you know, if our sole goal was to improve MCAS scores, we could take a really different strategy to education. There are districts that do, you know, when we used to go to those conventions, like we go to the National League of Cities, you know, you always had that workshop on worst to first. And you go in, wow, how did they do it? And it's because they became a test-driven school. You walk in the door, 50 days to the test, 49 days to the test. That's what they did. That's not who we are, and I don't think that's who we want to be. So we have this sort of schizophrenic sort of, you know, on one hand we say we don't want to be driven by MCAS, and we want to make sure we have art, and we want to make sure we have drama, and we want to make sure we have all these things that aren't measured on the MCAS scores. And then when MCAS scores aren't what they should be, we say, we're failing because our MCAS scores aren't good. I mean, you know, we could, if that's the goal, then there's a strategy to get there. I don't think that's what we want to do, though. That's certainly not what I want to do. So I think we have to be a little, keep that in mind.
In terms of the population, we're about to change the inclusionary zoning, which is going to add additional affordable housing, but also there's a three-bedroom requirement. So as those buildings get built over the, you know, the next 10-plus years, you know, we may see that may lead to an increase in families because now we're going to have more three-bedrooms on board. And then the two things in terms of to think about, certainly the early childhood education piece, and I know that that's going on, you know, with the city, and the city invested, I think, what was it, $1.5 million last year?
$1.3 million last year and $1 million coming into next year.
You know, I think there's probably a balance somewhere in the middle of, you know, being too cautious and buying 500 trailers tomorrow and creating a new program. You know, the hardest thing in education is to say to a parent in 5 years, this is going to be great because their kid is gone, right? And so I get the urgency, but you also, there's got to be some more of a balance there. The food piece, and this is something I feel really strongly about. When I first got on the school committee, we weren't really talking a lot about school climate, and it was thought of as a kind of a nice, warm, fuzzy Cambridge, hey, let's make sure everybody gets along and learns how to solve problems. And it really wasn't until people started to show that it actually impacted achievement and it actually impacted those test scores that everybody wants to be ruled by, that all of a sudden people said, whoa, wait a minute, maybe this isn't just a warm, fuzzy thing. Maybe there's a, you know, maybe we need to put some money behind it. I think food is that issue as well. It's not just about, and this alone would convince me, that, you know, let's make sure every kid actually has enough food. That, I think, would be worthy enough to do it. But the research is really clear. The kids do better in school. They're happier. They function better. Their families do better. I'm going to be coming out. I've been working with Kathleen and with Leland on looking at what would it cost to roll out a more expansive free food, free breakfast and lunch program in the schools. And maybe not necessarily for everybody, because I'm not sure that my kids need it. If funding's an issue, I think, you know, but using the income guidelines that came out of the Income Insecurity Committee that showed, for example, that a family of four needs to make $108,000 a year just to pay their rent, utilities, and food. That far exceeds what the guidelines that we use. So if we were to use guidelines that are more representative of Cambridge, we would capture a lot of those kids. So that's going to be coming up, but we're putting the final touches on that. So that is something that again, as I pointed out to Emily, you know, even if we increase the budget to that, we have no authority to tell you that that is where it should be spent. But I hope it is something that we think about, because I think it is that next piece of making sure kids, we're taking care of the whole child. And I think it's really important. So with that, we'll turn it over to the mayor, and then I'll just come back to say thank yous. Thank you, Madam Mayor.
First of all, I want to thank you, Mr. Finance Chair and Vice Mayor, and to our co-chairs for, I want to say, being brave. It's sometimes difficult because we don't do it enough to get together and have a conversation about our shared interests. Some of you may remember some time ago, when we had our first joint meeting, I said there's only one child, that child's name, all children. And that's what we have to always remember, that we may be on different sides of the balance sheet, but where it's all one pot of money and it's all for one goal, and that is to educate all children. So I'm very glad that we had this meeting. This is, I think, maybe the third meeting that we've had together. I look forward to our fourth meeting, which is our early childhood roundtable, because the more often we get together and talk about what we're thinking and what we know or don't know, the better we are in terms of policymakers. So I just think this is an important meeting, and I just want to thank the finance chairs, either on the school side and on the city side, for being brave to bring us all together, because I know we can be sometimes cantankerous, but I think it's our passion for the work that we do. And so just a few things. I've heard a lot of things. On one hand, people are saying we don't, you know, we spend so much money, and what do we see for it? And others are saying we don't spend enough. And we're always going to have that working at where's the right place. And in fact, I just want to mention, and thank you, Ms. Nolan, Ms. Spinner has the FY 2018 budget and enrollment projections, and those, I believe, will be up on the website. So if my colleagues, health colleagues, want to look through this document, I think that would be
very, very good, particularly as we prepare for our next conversation, which I guess, because I don't think Bill's squeezing another one of these in, but if we could, it might be good. So we'll be better informed when we look at, we have the budget conversation sometime in May. And I would ask that we think about perhaps coming together one more time, if time will allow, because I know there's a lot going on and that might make it very difficult. I think it's very interesting that we do think about the ideas and opportunities of cost sharing, because we do have some overlap. And I know Councilor Chung talked about, you know, more, you know, what about universal pre-K and where that is. I hear Mr. Fantini talking about, you know, should the school department be doing it or should we be doing it? And I think we should do it, and then we should figure out who should do it, who is best to do it. So I don't always think the school department has to do everything. I think we can work collaboratively and still educate the whole child. And we need probably to talk more about that, but I think we have more common ground than we think. I also want to say, it's not so much about the budget, but it's about telling our story. Just the conversation here says to me that we don't always know what the whole story about what we do as a city. As we teased out the budget, I think some people were a little bit more aware about how we spend our money and where it goes, and how it's very difficult if we even wanted to roll back some of our funding for certain items. It would not be as easy as one thinks, because once either the left hand might give it, the right hand isn't taking it back. It just doesn't happen, because people do want to hold on to those programs. I hear what you're saying about we should be a language immersion district, but that costs money. And how does that happen? And I'm just looking at you, and you had said language immersion district. So those are things that we need to talk about. You talked about coding. I think we should talk about coding too. Does the school department have to do that? Is that something that community schools could do? Or is the other side of the, again, of the ledger? Having these conversations together as a collegial elected body helps us think those things through. Maybe it is in the district. Maybe it's a shared project. I don't know. But every time we come together to have these conversations, we are all the better for it. And the district is better for it, and our children are better for it. So I just wanted to say thank you and acknowledge it wasn't easy to bring us all together. I'm very pleased that you wanted to spend your Valentine's Day with us in this meeting. But I think it was an important meeting. I still believe that. I do thank each of you for being here, and I'm going to cut my remarks there, because I do know it's Valentine's Day and you can still go out and have McDonald's. It's still early enough. But again, thank you very much for
your time. Thank you, Madam Mayor. I do have official business. There's an email that was received from Bill Bean. It will be entered into the record. And I also really want to thank the staff, because, you know, we're elected officials and we're here on Valentine's Day and we're here whatever, and that's kind of what we're paid to do. But, you know, there's a wall of people that have been here all day in the trenches doing the what, who are sitting here listening to us go on and on, and wondering about how difficult we're about to make their lives with some of the things that we're talking about. Who are here today as well, and we have such an incredibly dedicated staff, both on the city side and the school side, that I think that needs to be recognized. And just in closing, I would just say, you know, I agree with Emily in that we may debate what the best use of money is and class size or this, that, or the other thing, but I really hope, and I never want us to be in a position where we say we know that there's something that our school committee and our superintendent feels is good for the kids of this district, and we don't do it because of money. We may debate on whether what is that a good thing or is it not, and then we'll try it, and we'll measure it, and we'll see. But I don't want it to be, well, yeah, we think this is great, but it costs too much, we're not going to do it. If you think that there's something that we need to be doing, then we need to pay for it. So with